a dawn into the light. This child, innocent child, soft as a fawn, this child is born. One small heart, one pair of eyes, one work of art, here in my arms he lies, trusted and warm. Blessed this morn, a child is born.
Welcome, everyone, to our service, the second Sunday of Advent. As we just heard, we're welcoming back Mama Irene Llorente. It's good to see you. It's good to hear you. And of course, always delighted to welcome back our Reverend Sandy Butler, even though Sarah said she was my Reverend Sandy Butler, but there's enough to go around. I'm Roy Berkowitz. I'm your platform assistant. And here to welcome you and to guide us through today's program.
Last week, we lit the candle of hope and faith. Today, the second Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of peace. Maybe. There we go. Peace as a practice allows us to remain present amidst the noise and bustle of this human journey. This Advent season, let our prayer be that we dedicate ourselves to being the peace we wish to see in both our inner and outer worlds. And from John 14, verse 27, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you. I do not give you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. And so it is.
If you will join me in a centering inspiration, edited from Clarissa Pinkola Estes. What must I give more death to today in order to generate more peace? What do I know should die, but I'm hesitant to allow to do so? What must die in me in order for me to love, in order for me to be an agent of peace? What life am I afraid to give birth to? For if not now, when? And so it is. Mm-hmm.
There's a place in your heart, and I know that it is love. And this place, it was brighter than tomorrow. And if you really try, you'll find there's no need to cry. In this place, you'll feel there's no hurt or sorrow. There are many ways to get there. If you want to make a better place, make a little space, heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me. If you want to know why, there's a love that cannot lie. Love is strong, and it only cares of giving. If we try, we shall see. In this place we cannot feel fear or dread. We stop existing and start living. Then I be forgiven. If you care enough for the living, make a little space, make a better place, heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me. And the dream we were conceived in will reveal its joyful face. And the world we once believed in will shine again in grace. Then why do we keep strangling life when this heart crucifies its soul? Though it's plain to see the world is heavenly, be God's glow. We could fly so high, let our spirits never die. In my heart, I feel you are all my brothers. Create a world with no fear, together we'll cry happy tears. See the nations turn this words into password. There are many ways to get there. If you want to make a little space and make a better place, heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place, make a lovely place, heal the world, make it a better place for you and for me and the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me. Better place for you and for me and the entire human race. There are people dying. If you care enough for the living, make a better place for you and for me. For you and for me, you and for me, you and for me, you and for me, for you and for me.
Beautiful.
Thank you, Irene. And thank you, Roy. Both of you, I follow up with what Irene just sang, and for those of you that can reflect on what Roy said in his inspiration, with words from Eddie Hellison. Eddie Hellison is a Holocaust survivor, and Richard Rohr refers to her many times in his work and says quite forthright, he would not be where he is in his life without the writings of Eddie Hellison. And this is one that I think is most appropriate to begin our time together and to follow on what Irene just sang to us. We have one moral duty: to reclaim large areas of peace in ourselves, more and more peace, and reflect it to others. More peace in us, more peace in the world. Thank you, Eddie. I would also like to begin this time together by dedicating this time to E.J. Niles, Reverend E.J. Niles, who I consider one of my mentors. She spoke here, and I'm kind of filled up about that, and I've been working with it, and who better to work with me on it but you? So the time today is dedicated to peace, which is our second Sunday in Advent. And for some time, I have wrestled with peace. Surprise anyone? No, I doubt it. I have my own way of wrestling with peace, as do we all. And make no mistake about, we're not talking about passion or excitement. We are talking about our own internal peace. We are not talking necessarily today, although we could do a whole lot with it, on collective peace. Where I'm going with all of this is I'm using the Bible, Charles Fillmore, and Pema Chodron. Some of you are very familiar with Pema. Many of her works were done in the early 2000s, and a lot of us read many of her works. Today, I'm strictly sticking to a small volume that was published in 2006 that some of you may like to know about, Practicing Peace in Times of War. It's 100 pages. I've read it already 3 times, and each time I glean one more insight. So before some of you get too excited about, well, are we going to hear them all? No, we're not. We're going to stick with one. And it's called Shenpa. And I'll explain that in just a moment. But first, I just wanted to explore with you the Bible verse that is very well known. But let's read it again. And I say let's because you can read it quietly. You know probably most of it. And what you don't know, you will know that you know it on some level. And so it is, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Now, those are the words of Jesus telling us that God, through Holy Spirit, has given us the peace of God. It is one of what we call fruits of the Spirit. It's peace, love, joy, and there are 4 others, but we're not going there today. Peace is one of the fruits of Spirit. It's a gift. We all have peace. Ah, but you say, I don't always have peace. And I say, ah, but you do. You have to choose the peace. It's up to you. It's your choice, and as it is for all of us. And so the questions come forth many times in when we say, peace be with you. We say it sometimes to our friends. It used to be used a whole lot in our culture. We don't say it as much anymore. We used to be very, in unity in particular, peace be still. We said that constantly. It was part of our conversation. You have folks like myself who use, for my closing in many of the emails that I send, I'll say, be well, be peace. In other words, We are trying to speak to one another about a concept that really is a gift. And it's a gift that we always don't accept. And why is that? Well, if we look at what Pema says, and I'll say her name several times because many people don't necessarily know who she is. She's a Buddhist nun, an American Buddhist nun. She has written many volumes. And I liked this particular one on practicing peace in times of war. And here's what she says, flat out up front in the first chapter. So war and peace start in the human heart. Whether that heart is open or whether that heart closes has global implications. And she goes on to say, many of us get outraged at everyone else's wrongness. And it is in that outrage about everyone else's wrongness that our own private wars begin. And we begin those wars. And she uses this example by saying, look in the mirror when you're talking about everyone else and their wrongness and see who you're really speaking to. You're speaking to yourself because the war that you are about to embark on through words has already begun in you. And she throws out very definitely that we as human beings should make a vow to watch ourselves when we start to create war within ourselves, because we do it very often without even thinking about it. And it can be something as simple as she calls it, shenpa. And shenpa is something that all human beings do. It's a Buddhist Tibetan term, actually, that talks about this. And I will actually read this to you. But before I do that, I'll say this to you before I leave this particular chapter. There are many stories, but the basic message that she's trying to convey, Pema, is that to the degree that each of us is dedicated to wanting there to be peace in the world, then we have to take responsibility when our own hearts and minds harden and close. We have to be brave enough to soften what is rigid, to find the soft spot and stay with it. We have to have that kind of courage and take that kind of responsibility. That's the true practice of peace. And let me just say, the soft spot is a spot that is mostly very uncomfortable. It's change. It's a place where we don't like to be, and we spend a whole lot of time as human beings avoiding it wherever possible. We would rather not stay in the soft spot. We don't have the patience for it always. It hurts too much. And so the soft spot becomes something that in this talk, I'm going to ask you to start looking for in your own lives. You may already know exactly what I'm talking about. You may already be sitting in a soft spot that's mighty uncomfortable. I don't know. For purposes of what we're doing here this morning, which is a peace practice called Shenpa, I would like to make you very familiar with it. And if you are, hang in there. Because I believe it's a practice that we will use our entire lives. And for those of you that never heard of it before and really want to know how it's spelled, S-H-E-N-P-A, Shenpa. You can Google it. I did this morning. You'll have a ball. Go for it. It will also lead you to Pema. All right. And you can look all through Pema. But here it is. And I think you'll all get this. Have you ever had an itch? Well, of course you've had an itch. How many of you have ever been to the lake or to a cabin or walked outside in Washington in the heat of the summer when the skeeters are going, or come from the South where you all know all about that, or the North where you know about black flies? Have you ever had a itch? Itch, of course. What do you want to do with that itch? You want to scratch it. That is Shenpa. And if that's vivid enough for you as an example, because I would bet all of you know about Shenpa, if you just call it what it is, an itch and a scratch. It's that time between the itch and the scratch. Kind of like the music in our lives. There's the silence. It's that time that we are all not patient with because we don't like that time. we want to go right for the scratch, because the scratch will solve our problems and it will take away the itch. Now, many of us know that's not true. We have to go find the DEET or whatever else non-green thing we might be using to heal the itch. And some of you might not find this conversation very amusing at all. It's not meant to be amusing. It's meant to be a heartfelt discussion, bullseye look at, are you practicing peace? Do you know about Shenfa? I know you know about itching and scratching. And I know all of us have at one time or another been in that void, in that soft spot. Now, Pemmas tells us the soft spot is something we don't need to get too used to. She calls it and says it like it is. It's a sticky feeling. And it comes along with a very seductive urge to do something. Somebody says a harsh word and immediately you can feel a shift. There's a tightening that rapidly spirals into mentally blaming this person. That's called feedback sometimes. Do you remember feedback? When you get feedback that's not particularly constructive or helpful, it hurts. And you want to hurt back, or you want to slink away and not think about it and do something else that's more fun. It's all the same Shenpa. It's all that uncomfortable time between the itch and the scratch. And many of us do not wish to spend time there, will not spend time there. That, my friends, is exactly where, in that tightening, in that uncomfortable space, we then move from that space. And we both think and act from that space. We immediately move forward to the scratch. What is it, the scratch, for you? Let's take it out of the mosquito world. How about somebody comes to you and says something that you really find outrageous, either about you personally, about your family, about someone that you love. And you are in that spot where you have heard and felt the itch. And you want to, in a moment's time, if not less, respond accordingly. It is in that moment's time where Pema is telling us, stop. Pause right then and there, for there is your peace. You will come from that peace, from that moment of pause, in a different consciousness. You have to. Our consciousness don't stay the same moment to moment. And it is from that pause, if you will, from that practice of stopping before you willy-nilly go in to the scratch, if you will, that, or the tightening that comes and you willy-nilly want to get free from the tightening, you will change how you speak and act. You will come at that, whatever that is, the person that spoke ill of you or your family or your world or your country, call it whatever. We have programmed, all of us human beings, a response to things that make us uncomfortable, to things that we don't like, to things that we find outrageous. And the response can be one of two things. It can be a choice to respond in kind, like, who do you think you're talking to? I don't accept that. My goodness, where is that? Or you cannot say that, but you can choose to walk away and run that tape at 60, 50, 100 miles an hour in your mind. Who do they think they are? Why do they say those things? I'm not that way. How do they think? On and on and on. And it is your war. And I use that term war purposefully. Because many of us, because of the way we are in our culture and the way that our language hasn't always developed as it might, war means to us, many of us anyway, oh, you're talking about guns and ammo and boats and soldiers. No, I'm talking about war that goes on in your own heart. And all of us have warring hearts unless we take the time and spend the energy and do the practice of looking at where Shenpa is showing up in our lives. So what am I asking of you? I'm asking of you to become really more self-aware than you already are. This particular community is very self-aware. Now you need to kick it up a notch, okay? Because Shempa is going on with all of us, just at a maybe more sophisticated degree. When you get in a car and suddenly your thoughts are, I don't know why I did that. Let's put it on us. That I shouldn't have done that. Why did I speak that way? You're at war. You may not accept that word war, but you have a disruption in your life that you are now fully engaged with, as opposed to the peaceful, centered human being that we know we are. We have wandered away from that beautiful, peaceful center. We have not received the gift of God. It is a gift, this peace. It is a fruit of the Spirit. And in those times when we are disruptive or disrupted, it's our work that's made us disrupted. I see it in myself over and over. It started with me yesterday. I had set up a time for a young woman to be trained in a certain area of spiritual education. And we decided on a time, and I was going to call her. I called and there was no answer. And so I followed through initially. That was fine. And then I get an email that says, oops, I forgot. How about we do it at 4 o'clock this afternoon? Would that be okay? And I thought, okay, we'll do this. This is a good, we'll get 4 o'clock. I call again. There's no answer. I get another email that says, oh, I'm really sorry. I got stuck with blah, 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 blah. Okay. I tripped the light fantastic in the world of Reverend Sandy with that last one. And I said in my email back, no, that's not possible. I think we need to regroup and come up with a different time. Now, the fact of the matter is, in truth, it would have been possible, but I was having a time with it and I was going to have a time, but I was going to take it to prayer. That was my plan. I got off the phone. My prayer was to take it. My plan was to take it to prayer. And I started in. What's the matter with people that they can't tell time? Is it really that difficult that they can't get back to? What is the problem? It's theirs, class. They want me to blah, 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 blah. You hear it? You hear it? I know you hear it because you got your own stuff you're dealing with. It's your own shenpas. And what does that mean? That means I went into overdrive as soon as I felt the itch. I had to scratch it. I had to make myself feel uplifted. Really? That's uplifted, Reverend Sandy? Oh, come on. That's about as far south from uplifted as one can get. But here's the good news. I noticed what I was doing. I haven't always done that in my lifetime. Now, I'm not trying to give you a line. This is not the first time that I've noticed. I've noticed. But I'm bringing it to you because I hope you've noticed as well. It's a practice that's ancient that can help us pause, become centered in the Christ of our being, and then respond. And what does that do? That does what Eddie is talking about, Eddie Hilsum. Find the peace in yourself and expand it. Those of us that walk around, and I include myself, thinking that I am a peaceful human being most of the time, I don't think that's true anymore. I don't think that I spend enough time being aware of when I start down the slippery slope of giving my peace away, of not accepting the gift of peace that is mine from the moment I was incarnated here on earth. I'm giving it away, such a precious gift. And so then I say to myself, wow, this is a wonderful practice and I want to know more about it. So what I'm going to ask you to do is to remember that Shempa is one practice. Pema gives us several others, and you might find these interesting, and we won't go through all of them. But one is change your attitude toward pain. Oh my, some of you are like, uh-oh, I know about this one. I know about this one. Do you? Pain is a teacher. We suffer in pain. And yes, there's all kinds of ramifications of that too. But that is a kind of war when we don't accept our pain. When we fight with that pain, we don't see the blessing at all, and it changes the peaceful person that we can be and that we are. So she tells us to look at pain and ask the question, can you sit with suffering? Keeping in mind, there's all kinds of pain, right? Emotional pain, physical pain. Our world is in pain. Can you sit with the suffering? And some of you will say right away, the immediate reaction is, I don't want to sit with suffering. I don't like the way this talk is going. I will have no more of it. Boom, Shenpa. There was no space between what I said and your reaction. Now, some of you may have had a different reaction. Yes, I can sit with suffering. I know what that is, and I know how to begin to navigate that. And here's my add-on question for you. If you do, do you share that with the world? And what does that look like? That looks like a person that's a peacemaker that's looking to gain more and more peace in their lives. And they share that by demonstrating the peace that already is in their lives. So it's a quandary, and you sit with it and you ask the question. But all of us know how to be peacemakers. The question comes, as Pema says, in your awakened heart, you're fully present to what it means to be a peacemaker. But when we start slipping, and we're human, so we do, we lose that idea. We don't remember, as we like to say. And we return to the pattern of immediately reacting. We know what the answer is. I've studied this. I know what the answer is. And is there no time for you to say, well, maybe there's a different answer? Maybe there's a way I can stand in the other guy's shoes for a while and see what makes them, him, her, come at a way of being and think it's just as important as my way of being. That is a peacemaker. Just that stopping with that one thought of, ah, I think there's another way. Or if I don't think so, I'm willing to listen. I'm willing to investigate. Oh, by the way, I'm willing to use my curiosity to find out if there is. That's the kind of thinking that Pema is trying to bring to the world. And she's been quite successful. And I'm saying to you, there are things that she is saying, in addition to changing your attitude about pain, such as, she asked this question, can I touch the center of my pain? Can I sit with suffering, both yours and mine, without trying to make it go away? My goodness, friends, I've done prayer work myself when I've literally said, we see no pain. You will be in no pain next week. This is as Sandy is a young minister. What am I talking about? I don't have that authority. Who told me we would see no pain next week? You see how ludicrous we can be, and we do it sometimes in the name of love, in the name of wanting someone to feel better. Who do we want to make feel better? Us. I want to make it better for me, okay? So I feel better, and then I want to make it better for you so we both can feel better. Back it off is what Pema's saying. Back it off and sit in the space and get, as we say in unity, your Christ consciousness and the creative ideas that come if you sit in the space before we react to patterns that we know that we've used over time. So the last thing that I will bring here to you is this. If you want there to be peace, anything from peace of mind to peace on earth, here's the condensed instruction. Stay with that initial tightening or itch, if you will. Don't spin off like we sometimes do. Keep it simple. Move in and from compassion. And don't make a big deal out of what is pleasant and what is unpleasant. And some of you will say, I'm not sure I get that last part. And I'll say to you, work on it. Because many of us spend a lot of time saying how pleasant everything is, and we don't mean it for a hoot. We just want to feel better. We just want it all to be pleasant. I'm not saying not be authentic. If you're having a pleasant time, you be authentic. But stop with the on and on and on. If I say it, it's pleasant, it is. It reminds me of my early days in Unity. If I say an affirmation 10 times, then it really is. Okay, it's really going to work because I said it 10 times. If there's no heart, if there's no peace, if there's no natural, I know, I affirm I am a child of God. That is a peaceful peacemaker. And so I'm going to ask now that we take these small yet powerful practices into a time of meditation. And what does the time of meditation mean? Peace. Be still. And so at this moment in time, in this place of peace, simply allow the breath, our beautiful breath, to be our peace. The breath of life, the giving and the receiving of peace. We are grateful for this time of peace, and we vow here and now to create peace, to be the peace, and not just be peaceful. For when you are the peace, you are already filled with the peace of God that passes all understanding, that needs no definition. And sometimes we don't remember that. And so in this particular time of meditation, let us remember the gift of peace and to say, on this day, I dedicate myself to peace on earth. I accept myself without harsh judgment and express appreciation for me, my individual expression of the divine. I live without fear and meet the events of this day with confidence. I accept others without prejudice and experience a sense of unity with all people. In harmony with myself, my life, and all others, I am a peacemaker. I live this day with a peaceful mind, a peaceful heart, and a peaceful spirit. And for a precious moment of silence, allow that peace to be your peace, and peace, and peace, and never-ending peace. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. for my peace I leave with you. And now, my friends, we leave peacefully, we live in joy, with grateful, awakened hearts. Bless you. Amen.
Within us, peace.
in peace. Help us find peace. Find peace, my sweet Lord.
Thank you.
And now, if you'll join me in a closing prayer. This is a prayer for unity by Jay McDaniel that I've edited quite a bit. May we listen to one another, those near and those far, in openness and mercy. May we listen to plants and animals in wonder and respect. May we listen to our own hearts in love and forgiveness. May we listen to spirit in quietness and awe. And in this listening, which is boundless, may we find the wisdom to cooperate with a healing spirit, a divine spirit who beckons us into peace and community, and who sustains our vision of a peaceful future and gives us strength to work unceasingly to make that vision real. We ask for deep listening. We ask for an awakened heart. We ask for a better world, and we take responsibility for co-creating that better world, a world of peace. And so it will be.
We are so blessed here at Unity Center DC for extraordinary speakers, talented musicians who share with us each week their God gift, their message, their inspiration. And for us as recipients, I'd like you to take this moment and be grateful. If you want to express your gratitude by giving a gift to Unity Center DC, it's possible. We'll put up on the screen the options, but you can give online, you can mail a cash or a check to the address you'll see on the screen, so that we can continue this ministry, which has blessed us all. Thank you.